As we go into your word today, may we open the lid, take the lid off, and receive from you the blessing of your word that will transform us from the inside out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God is awesome. He's better than we praise him sometimes. I always tell people that if your pain is at a 10, or the problems that you got are at a 10, your praise ought to be at 11. Because your praise needs to be better than your problems. And I don't know what you're going through, but I just wish I could get people to praise God at the level that they know that God is going to bring them out of whatever they're in. Do I have anybody in the building that you believe that whatever you're going through, that God is going to bring you out victorious? Do I have any believers in here that know that whatever you are going through, God is going to bring you out victorious? Now, I said, do I have anybody in the building that you believe beyond the shadow of a doubt?
Worshiper
is that you know how to praise him in the in-between. I don't have what he told me I'm going to have yet. Somebody holler yet. But while I'm waiting on what he promised, from where I started to where I'm going to finish, I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praises shall continually be in my mouth. So we went through an in-between time, and then we got to Pentecost. And at Pentecost, we found out that it was God's power. It was God himself showing up, and the mighty signs and wonders that took place, the rushing of the mighty wind, and we could hear it fill all the house where they were sitting, and then cloven tongues, divine tongues like fire, sat on each of them, and they all were filled with the Holy Spirit. We began to look at the power of Pentecost, and I talked about how it got our senses involved, what we hear and what we see, and then ultimately ending up in what we say. Because what we say has a great impact on how we live. And so a lot of us need to speak with a new tongue. Your language says a lot about where you're from and about where you're going. And so we all need to, on a level, speak in a new tongue. And yes, the spiritual side of that, yes, and the Lord gets a hold of your language, but I'm also talking about in the practical side. That there are some of you who cannot get to where you need to get to because your language is holding you back. The things you say that come out of your mouth, the Bible says that in the tongue there's the power of life and death. And a lot of us have spoken death over our own situation. There's no way we can get out of here. There's no way we can do this. There's no way that we will conquer this. As a matter of fact, we even get so far as to say, I quit. I give up. I don't want to do it anymore. If you're speaking that kind of language in your life, if you're sowing those kind of seeds in your life, you are going to have a hell-filled life. And it's not God's fault. You are reaping what you sow. Amen. So we got to start speaking a new language. Amen. Every time somebody tells you that you can't,
all right,
agree with them. Tell them you're absolutely right. Yeah. I can't do it. But I am depending on God's power. I cannot do this by myself. I am solely depending on God's power. I know that in a few days we're going to celebrate America's independence, but independence does not bleed itself over into the body of Christ. We are solely dependent on God's power. Don't get it twisted. Don't think that you are doing it.
to signify that it had life, it began to speak. You know, when a baby is born, first thing they do is smack it on the bottom. And that baby begins to speak. We call it screaming. The church goes through all of this and is born and begins to speak. And people begin to hear in their own language. They begin to hear people who were not originally from where they were from speaking in their own language. They could understand that there was somebody from another place speaking in a language that they were not native to, and they could understand it. Nobody can do this but God.
Not all of us.
You can't say it the same way. You speak those words. Fly over to the other side. want you to dig a little deeper. I just want you to see on the surface what God is doing with the big church. I want you to see what he's doing with people. If you remember in your lesson this morning as we read, the scripture says that Peter, the enemy, desires to sift you as wheat. He desires to break you down. Isn't that seem like that the enemy trying to do to you? All the stuff you got on your plate, it's all an attempt in the enemy to break you down. It ain't one thing. Fix the car, the refrigerator go away.
Yeah.
to make a statement. Not me putting the oil on you, or you falling out under the power of the anointing. Because you can fall down one way and get up the same way. It's not even about you all coming to church, but we come to church, we come to learn, we come to experience worship, we come to God's house because He told us to, we're commanded to, but your transformation is going to all be by God's power. Stop looking for the shortcuts. There are no shortcuts when it comes to God. It is all by His power. Yeah. Are you depending on God's power?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Are you leaning to your own understanding? Your own understanding will get you in trouble.
Yeah.
You know, I was praying, talking to God one day, and I said, Lord, I know you're tired of me. I know you're tired of me falling off and getting back on. Y'all don't talk to him like that.
Yes, sir.
Lord, I know you're tired of me. You gotta be tired of me. I've been worrying you a long time. And some of the stuff I've been worrying you with, I done had a long time, and I still got it, Lord. What's going on? I mean, are you tired of me? I know you're tired. I done talked to you. I done ran. I done left. I done came back. I done said I wasn't gonna do it, and I said I am gonna do it, Lord. I don't know, Lord. I know you're tired of me. And the word came back to me so strong. He said, don't think for me because you don't know me that well. I went to the word to confirm what he said. And he said over in 1 Peter 3 and 9. Or the 2 Peter. Which one is it? 2 Peter 3 and 9. He says, I'm not slack concerning my promises, but I'm long-suffering. I'm patient. He said, I can wait you out, man. You think about trying to run from me and avoid me that I'm tired of you? He said, I got long patience. I'll wait on you. He said, and even if I have to move heaven and earth to get you to where you need to be. Philippians chapter 1 verse 6 says, because I have begun a good work in you, I got to finish what I started. I don't care who you are, how far you run, how far you stray away, God is patient. He's going to wait on you.
Amen.
Now what he might do in the waiting process is he may let things, allow things to happen to get you to refocus back on him. It's not because he hates you. It's because he loves you. And he loves you so much that he would rather see you be saved than to be comfortable. You want comfort first. And what God wants is commitment. It ain't gonna always be comfortable. But I promise you, if you remain committed, the day that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So run with winged as eagle, they shall run and not be weary, they shall walk and not faint. Wait on the Lord and be of good courage. Heart, not with your power, but His power. Lord, I'm depending on your power. Let's pray. Father God, in your word, you have said that disciples asked the question, who is the greatest among us? And you answered it, you said, those of us who are servants are greater. We need your power to be good servants. We don't know how to be on our own. We have our own little mind and thought process that we think how things should go, but we need your power. Today we declare that we are depending on you. This is not us releasing our responsibilities. But what we are saying, Lord, is we need your power to fulfill what you've given us.
God depending on your power. We can't be good parents, we can't be good husbands, good wives, good church members, we can't be good community members without your power. Depending on your power, and we will not allow anybody to minimize your hand in our lives. We will not allow anybody to minimize your presence in our lives. We will not stand by while somebody said, oh, they must be drunk. We will say, no, this is God's power. So we thank you. Just like you poured it out on that day of Pentecost, you still are pouring it out today. And we as a body of believers receive your power in Jesus' name. Now Lord, as we go forth and continue on with our service and commune with you and with each other, forgive us. Wash us clean of those things that we think have set us apart from you. Help us to know that you're not tired of us. That you factored in all of our wrongdoing and still chose us. You knew that we were going to be like we were before you chose us, but you chose us anyhow. But you didn't choose us to stay the same. As long as we stay connected to your power through Bible study and prayer meeting and fellowship, studying your word, we will grow in grace. So forgive us. And as we commune together, help us to realize that this is all about you and not about us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.